stay calm when you make a mistake. Try to just pick yourself up, reverse the work. You can fix it. And again, like Blake and Paige said, just own it. I mean, if you realize you make a mistake and you're the one to catch it, bring it up and try to fix it. You can get the help you need. You should definitely not try to cover it up because that just makes it a lot worse.
I've made more than I'd care to admit as far as mistakes. I made one this morning. I didn't wear a leather jacket when I was a parent. But when it comes to work mistakes that I've really learned from, so one of the ways you can buy things from Home Depot is you can buy something on our website, and it's in our store already, and you can go and you can pick it up in a couple hours. So what we do is we see what we have in our stores, and we show it on our website. And so there's reasons that we got to turn off a specific store. Maybe there's like a hurricane that's about to hit Florida, and so it's going to be closed. We got to turn it off. And there's reasons we need to turn off a certain item. So maybe, you know, we don't want to sell Christmas lights online for some reason. So a couple years ago, part of my job was to manage that. And so it was, you know, of course, it was like 4:45 on a Friday, and I got this email. Somebody was up in arms. We had to turn something off. So I go in, done it 1,000 times before, click, 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 all done, and then went back to my desk, was ready to go home, and thought to myself, something doesn't feel right. You know that feeling you get in your legs where you just like, you know you screwed something up? So I get back in the tool, and I had not just turned off the one item. I had turned off every store everywhere.
You have a lot of power. I do.
Yeah,
you
know? more than I should be allowed to have sometimes. And so I see it and it says processing. So I'm like, okay, thank God it hasn't happened yet, but it's gonna. And so I quickly ran and got to my, you know, looked in Outlook for my IT partner and started calling their boss, and their boss didn't pick up until somebody finally picked up. And so fortunately, this mistake didn't actually happen, but I still want to throw up on the stage right now thinking about it. You know, I could have prevented, you know, thousands of orders and who knows how much money from happening. So there's a couple of things I took away from that. One, it's, you know, making sure that from day one you understand who your partners are and who you can partner with, because things are going to happen. So you need to know who you can lean on to help fix mistakes when they happen. Two is obviously attention to detail. That has never happened again, and so help me God, it never will. And then three is I kind of changed jobs over time, and now I have, you know, associates that I work with and they report to me. It's understanding that things do happen. And so when I work with my team and something goes wrong, you know, I have the perspective of, okay, well, they didn't turn everybody off for everything like I did. And as long as we're not making mistakes over and over again, it's important to have that for sure.
That's great. One thing I say is, you know, no matter what, whole career, don't take your highs too high or your lows too low. You know, that it's because they're going to be both. I'll give you one quick piece of advice from mine, kind of a different angle, mistake I made, important one for you as you're kind of planning your career and your journey. There was a point years ago where my boss ended up leaving Nike, and so there was an opportunity at the next level for a promotion. And and by the way, at the time, I was running a killer business. I was ahead of budget of kind of, if you were to look at my peer competition, my business was the most solid, running the best, and, you know, I was feeling really good about my prospects and my potential. And so, you know, I kept, you know, my nose down, kept running the business, made sure that, you know, my team was strong, business results were good. And one day the president called me into his office, and he said, "Heidi, you want that job, don't you? Do you want that job? Your boss that just left?" And I said, "Yes, of course I do." And he said, "Well, I didn't know that." And he said, "You know, this other person has been in my office every day, every week, every day, letting me know that he wanted this job, and showing me his credentials and his passion for the job. And you know, I don't think anyone could have matched my passion for that job or wanting the step in the next." And they gave him the job. He got the job. And you know, of course, I was crushed. And so step, you know, part one of my advice is you own your career. The company doesn't own your career. Your boss doesn't own your career. You own your career and your career mapping. lesson number two of this for me is resilience, because you're going to have bumps. And you know, I might have given myself 24 hours to feel really sorry for myself and, you know, kind of hide away. But, you know, I did. I came back, and I was strong, and I was resilient, and I tried to drive even harder. And, you know, to my boss's credit, you know, also maybe this is advice as a manager, you know, he saw that. He recognized that I didn't give up, and kind of that bump actually made me fight harder, want it more, think bigger. And he came back, it wasn't even a year later, and offered me a promotion. And you know, when he looked me in the eye and he hugged me and we talked about this role, it was very clear to him that what it meant to him that I held on and I stuck through it all, and I was resilient. And so it's amazing things will happen, both if you manage your own career and if you're resilient in times like that. You will be rewarded. It gets so noted. So I was clearly overambitious. I like 5 more questions. I'm looking at the time, and I want to make sure, you know, I can come back with some questions, but I want to make sure we open it up to you guys. Is that okay with you all if we turn it this way? Yeah. And we'll take questions from you guys, and if I have time at the end, I might ask one more of this amazing team, and I know they might stick around a little too to answer some personal ones. So there's some, I think that we've got some microphones out there. Yeah? Yeah? Cool. Okay. Oh, that's great. Okay. You guys can manage yourself. Nice job. Okay. Wow. Very organized. Can you talk louder? Sorry.
Yeah.
I don't think it's on.
Okay. I can talk louder. Yeah. Hi, my name is Cameron Hudson. I'm from the University of Alabama. And I just wanted to ask you about soliciting feedback in your role and using that as a mechanism to grow. What are the best ways to do that and to make sure we use that in the best way?
Great. Just in case the room can't hear, I'll repeat it. You make sure I'm getting it right. What's our advice as a crew around soliciting advice and feedback in your roles and how you incorporate that into your future and your growth? Fair?
Yes.
Okay. What I'm going to do on these, is it okay if I just like pick 2 so we can keep things going, give the answer? Lauren, you okay with that one?
Yeah.
Okay, great.
That's a great question. And at West Elm, I mean, we always say this, feedback is a gift. And sometimes it's really hard to get feedback if it's not exactly what you want to hear. But it's really important to take it in store ops. I feel like my entire job is based off of listening to feedback from the stores. And an example of that, I mean, our stores were finding it really difficult to track their supplies. They were going over budget every month. They just really had no visibility into what they were spending. So I listened to that. I worked with our finance team. I made them their own budgets, their own trackers. I really listened to exactly what they needed and implemented it. And this year it's been so successful. We saved a lot of money on the supply front. No one is begging for bags and boxes and whatever else they might need. So just really listen to what people are saying. That's everything.
Yeah. And then I would say, when you're thinking about your own career and you're thinking about feedback, I'd say be direct. You know, you're going to have bosses that are great about giving feedback in your career. You're going to have bosses that aren't great about giving feedback in career. And the one thing that I took away from my first boss at the Home Depot was, I never want review time to be a surprise for you. You're going to get reviews. You never want to hear new things during that time. So I would say, when you go in, you know, you're working somewhere, you're probably going to have pretty frequent updates with your boss. I can't remember the last time I haven't ended up an update with my boss saying, like, what can I do better for you? So be direct and make sure that, you know, when it comes to review time, it's not a surprise.
I would also ask for real-time feedback. I think it's really important that, you know, let's say you have a big presentation, right, to get it immediately, because then it's fresh in your boss's mind as well, and they'll probably have the most constructive and robust feedback to give you. I mean, I know at Belk we also have a big mentoring program, which I think is also helpful as far as feedback, because you have someone to bounce ideas off of that isn't necessarily your direct manager, but that might work with you in an indirect way and see you in some of these meetings or, you know, be privy to some of this information. So I also think that that's really important to acquire a mentor quickly once you get into your job.
That's great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name's Nicole Richling. I'm from Bowling Green State University. And my question is actually for you, Heidi. I know you said you tell your employees to think about what 3 things they want to be famous for. So I was kind of wondering what your 3 things were.
Okay. Wow. Well, you know, I I'm just going to give one at a point in time, and it's with my last role. Is that okay?
Yes.
Because it'll just be a concrete example. And before I had my current role, about 3 years ago, I ran the global women's business at Nike, which is an amazing job. What I said to myself, and it was a year where things were going incredibly well, numbers were great. It was kind of that scenario I said. It was, you know, we were like business was good. And what I said to myself is that the women's business at Nike is very important to Nike. And at the same time, the women's business is a little more complicated. Maybe women can be a little more complicated, I don't know. But we have some playbooks at Nike that we run really well. You know, we've been with football, basketball, running, and for as much as we innovate, there's kind of the standard playbook. And I stepped back and I said, okay, a playbook for running the women's business is, and one of the magic pieces of it about Nike is we always innovate, but we have kind of this foundation of this playbook that has worked for us since the beginning and the founding of Nike. And so it's like this balance of innovate and know who we are in our playbook. And I thought, you know, if I stood back, is we've had amazing years and decades of the women's business, but we don't have a playbook that can be our playbook that can stand the test of time. And so I said to myself, let's not just build a business for a year, but let's build the playbook for the women's business that, for example, when I'm not running it, when leaders move on, when we have new designers on the business and new teammates, that we can have that playbook that will stand the test of time. So we did that, and we running a women's business looks slightly different. You know, women don't think of themselves as athletes, but they are because they're run and they're fit. So how does that play out in the playbook? And the use of celebrities and influencers is really important in running the women's business, and the role of style is elevated. And so we built a playbook that, you know, you can think about the women's business 10 years from now, and it will be different, the world will be different, but it's a playbook that we can stand with. And so that was one that we did, and I'm super proud of that because the women's business has been on an amazing trajectory, so it's those kind of things, you know. And I would say right now, what I did in this current role, I will say one more, is, you know, Nike has been, is the best, arguably the best innovator, one of the best innovators, you know, industry aside, and we are known for our innovation in apparel and footwear. But what I wanted to do in retail at Nike is to bring some of the protocol and best practices from innovating for footwear and apparel and bring it to retail. And because what better company to be at the forefront of innovation for retail than Nike, and to bring a consumerist approach to retail. So we kind of elevated that. We opened a retail experience center in Portland and are doing amazing things in innovation that wasn't my job. It was kind of stepping above and trying to be famous.
Thank you so much.
Sure, thank you. Nice to meet you.
Hi everyone, my name's Mary Beck and I'm in the College of Communication at the University of Alabama. And I actually have a question for Lauren. I was wondering how your education in the College of Communication at BU helped you prepare for your career in retail and your current position at West Elm.
Awesome, great question. I'm happy you asked that, actually, because I think this will be very relevant for everyone. So the thing about colleges, for me at least, it was really more about learning the skills that you need to go into the world rather than learning the exact experience in school. I mean, in communication specifically, in college, I was working on projects with people, which I'm sure you're doing the same, constantly working on projects, constantly pulling a team together. Now I'm a project manager. I mean, it's learning how to write in a way that's succinct and you get your point across. You're writing emails all day long to people and writing the best emails you can write so that follow-up isn't needed so much. I mean, we all get a million emails every day, and if you can just kind of condense that into one thought that's clear and eloquent, I mean, that's the way to go. So, like I said, it's just really about the skills that you learn, and communication, you could go a ton of different directions with that.
That's great.
Thank you.
Thanks, Mary.
Hi there, my name is Nick from Bowling Green State University. My question is, how have you been challenged due to a decision you've made due to your age, and what was your reaction and outcome?
Blake, you want to start?
Oh gosh, in relativity to my age. Well, when I was an intern and an assistant designer, so those are the entry-level positions you can have in fashion design, it's very difficult to get your point across and be recognized that you actually do have a really good idea and it's not just filler, you know, because a lot of people think that college students are a little bit up in the clouds and not necessarily thinking about reality. So you really have to prove them with facts, and if you can come to the table with a lot of research and kind of proving a point for white space or behind your idea, then it really does help you to get realized that you are relevant for that issue.
Thank you very much.
Great. Well, I think we just got a signal. Oh no. Okay, well, you know, I have more questions. I'm sure you guys have more questions. And I think we're gonna stay around for lunch, is that fair to say? Where there might be a chance for you guys to spend a couple minutes, ask a few one-to-one questions. But again, you know, on behalf of the National Retail Federation Foundation and of this amazing crew, thank you for the passion and I see and the kind of the light we see in this room and your faces and what you are going to do for changing the world for consumers and for us as leaders, thinking about having people like you with this much passion to commit this time in our business, making consumers' lives better, our companies better, and our careers better, making us think differently. We're excited to see that and to see what you do outside of this room. So here's to you guys, and here's to your future. Thank you.